So good afternoon, everybody. This is our next session for today. So it's session 3G. We have two presentations. The session will be moderated by myself and Rebecca. I hope that by now you know our faces, but for those of you who are not familiar with us, I am a lecturer in water engineering here at WEDC with research interest in water and wastewater treatment and energy from waste. And Rebecca, if you want to real quick.
Hi, everyone. If I haven't met you in an earlier session or in a previous life, I'm Rebecca Scott, a lecturer here at WEDC, particularly interested in aspects to do with sanitation systems, rural, urban, sustainable and equitable solutions. So I'm very interested in these two presentations coming up.
Yeah.
Thanks, Tanja.
Sure. Okay, so as we said, two presentations. We will follow the usual format. So first we will play presentations and then we will invite authors to join Q&A session and potentially answer to your questions. So the first presentation is by Marie Danielle Sebgo.
Hello, everyone. I'm very happy to be here today at the 42 WEDC conference. My name is Danielle Sebgo from Burkina Faso. I'm in charge of research and knowledge management at WaterAid Burkina Faso. Today, I will be presenting the results of our recent implementation of a technology we designed to help people living with disability to have a better access to toilets. In this presentation, after the introduction, we will discuss the WASACHER concept, the implementation step in Burkina Faso, the results and the lessons learned. We will finish with the next step. It is estimated that 15% of the global population is living with a form of disability. In Burkina Faso, it is at least one person in 15 households. The problem here is because our toilets are not adapted to people living with disability, they cannot use them correctly without any help. Also, in health center, some patients are severely sick. They are so weak, they cannot move the toilet. In this case, they can even soil or wet themselves. Also, they do not have any form of intimacy and they lose their dignity. The problem is, we still consider these people as a minority. So, adapting toilet to these people will increase their cost, making toilet not affordable. So, it is critical to come up with a technology that will help people living with a disability to access to sanitation services. WASA is a toilet chair. It is designed to be used by persons living with disability, but also by a person in health center. It gives them autonomy and intimacy. In the Bambara local language, WASA means dignity. The WASA chair was initially introduced by the WaterAid West African regional teams in Burkina Faso. WASA chair was designed following six principles, which were later used to evaluate the effectiveness of the chair. These principles are: it should allow multiple uses and multiple functions. It should be locally manufactured. It should be practical. It should be hygienic easy to clean and maintain. And finally, it should be affordable. The implementation of the wheelchair chair was carried in Burkina Faso. This country has a population of 20 million people, of which 1.2% are living with disability. The implementation was carried from January 18 to May 21 in the Cascade region, located in the southwestern part of the country. The Cascade region was selected because WaterAid has ongoing activity related to health centers. The WeDC implementation was carried in two phases. The steps during the phases were similar, except that during the second phase, there was a workshop with persons living with disabilities to discuss the chair design. Here, you can see on the right side a picture of the version 1 of the wheelchair chair tested during phase 1 and the picture of the version 2 tested during phase 2. The evaluation of the wheelchair chair was overall found to be very good. On the left side, you can see the evaluation in household. On the right side, you can see the evaluation in health center. In household, the comfort, the multiple uses, the relevance, and the concept were rated above 4 out of 5. In health center, the evaluation was similarly above 5 for the concept, the comfort, the multiple uses, and the relevance. Only the shape and resistance were rated little less in both household and health center. The users of the wheelchair chair proposed to improve the chair resistance and stability by increasing the clamping and also using stronger materials. Another important point is the cost of the chair, found to be high. The wheelchair chair actually costs around $185 and users propose to reduce it to a range of $45 to $135. We are showing here a testimonial from a user of the wheelchair chair. Mr. Buguma told us the following. The wheelchair chair helps me a lot daily and I'm grateful to WaterAid for this initiative. Concerning the lesson learned, the approach that we used during the wheelchair chair design was effective because it was carried in an inclusive way. However, the shape and resistance of the chair should be improved by reinforcing the chair frame using stronger materials. The next step of this implementation are the following. First, you should make a comparison with this implementation result from Mali and Niger, where the process is still ongoing. Also, we believe that some people living with disability could be trained to the manufacturing of the chair. Finally, we believe WaterAid could make a case of the wheelchair chair to the authorities for a wider adoption of this innovation. We are getting to the end of this presentation. Thanks to all the project team members at WaterAid and our partner of implementation in the rural communities in Burkina Faso. Thank you for your kind attention. We are ready to answer your questions.
Thank you very much. Marie Danielle, and I hope that you can now join us with a video and audio. Marie, can you hear us? Can you please accept my invite for video and audio so that you... For everybody else, I switched the mode to discussion mode so that everybody can speak up and ask their questions directly. Marie, we cannot see you. Rebecca, can you see?
No, it may just be taking some time to process through.
Yeah.
Depending on where Marie is. I guess in the meantime, we could ask people if they have questions, they can ask them and Marie can respond in the chat if she can't. make it to the audio space.
Yes, you can type your question or we can also try to for you just to join in and ask directly. But first we need to have our presenter.
Yes, I'm just wondering if Marie can just accept the audio, if not the video. Maybe that's one. Can we make her a presenter? Would that give her easier access?
Can you?
I'll see if I can make a presenter.
Please do. Okay.
Marie, if you need to switch on your camera or your microphone, that would be great. You don't see Marie at all. It looks like, Andres, you can see her, but I can't.
So, okay, we have a question from Brian as well. So, Marie. Thank you, Brian.
Marie, are you able to type in the chat box?
Can you hear us? I think we lost her.
I guess what we could do is for people to type questions, and then we can move to the next presentation, and we can come back and see if Marie's been able to join or at least answer questions in the chat.
I think so.
I'm sure there will be a number of questions. So how about we try that? Because I know we've got the other presenters here.
Okay, so let's continue. Marie, if you can hear us, hopefully. Okay, so we go back to presentation mode and I will play the next presentation then. Should we leave Marie as a presenter, Rebecca?
Maybe not for the moment, but we'll bring her back.
Okay.
Welcome to this presentation. My name is Priya Nath, and I will be presenting with my colleagues, Kanika Singh from Water Aid India and Gloria Gafuria from Water Aid Tanzania. Today, we'll talk to you about our work on female-friendly public and community toilets, the guide that we co-authored, assessments that we have done, and learnings that we take away. But first, why do we focus on this area? One of the most common forms of gender discrimination that women and girls experience daily is the lack of access to private, comfortable, and convenient toilets. While toilets in the home are the best solution, Women and girls need to move around, engage in economic and education activity, and in some cities and towns, live in situations where individual household sanitation remain a big challenge. Therefore, public and community toilets remain a very big priority for women and girls. Recognizing this, WaterAid, UNICEF, and Water and Sanitation for the Urban Poor carried out research in 2018. We wanted to produce an easy-to-use guide to help make community and public toilets more female-friendly. This guide is designed to help planners and decision-makers go about their daily work. The guide focuses on six key requirement areas for female-friendly toilets. More details about what specifically we mean under each area can be found in the guide itself. But for example, under the heading of safe and private, we are talking about being in a safe location, having clearly marked female toilet sections with separate entrance, having good lighting, having trained male and female attendants available, and having robust private cubicle structures. The second part of the guide focuses on how to incorporate city or town-wide assessments to understand how many community and public toilets there currently are, where they are located, and to what extent they meet these female-friendly requirements, as well as understand what action needs to be taken to make them more female-friendly. I now hand over to my colleagues Gloria and Kanika for examples of how we've put this guide into practice.
Thank you very much, Priya. So in Tanzania, this study was conducted in Babati Town, located in the north of Tanzania. The stakeholders involved were WaterAid Tanzania, Nelson Mandela Institution of Science and Technology, as well as Babati Town Council. The objectives of the study were particularly to assess how female-friendly and inclusive public and community toilets in Babati Town in Manyara are. And the study aimed specifically to locate public and community toilets in facilities in Babati, to create a georeferenced database and inventory of female-friendly public and community toilets in Babati Town. And the third one was to conduct an assessment of selected public and community facilities in Babati Town. The study covered four public toilets and one communal toilet in Babati Town. These toilets are located in four wards in Babati Council. The features assessed found out that the toilets did not include safety and privacy for females. They did not cater for menstrual and other hygiene management requirements. They also were not accessible to all, including the disabled persons, and they were not affordable and were also unavailable when needed, especially at night. All public and communal areas had toilets but have not been catering for the female needs. That is what we found out in the battle. So what needs to be done? The best part is to enforce hygiene by laws, especially in public toilets, specifically in towns and city areas, so that the toilets can meet female-friendly requirements. WaterAid Tanzania needs to liaise with the government of Tanzania to innovate adaptive models of female-friendly toilets that will influence the wash sector. Also, the third one is to develop the operation and maintenance standards for the operational of the public toilets in Tanzania. That is in the pub, in the markets, and as well in the community toilets. So these are the findings of how we found out the findings. So in the safety, different criteria were set. Seven criteria were there. The very first one was safety and privacy, whereas in all bus, three bus stands were quite okay, as well as in the markets. The second criteria was the catering of the menstrual and other hygiene management requirements. Only one met the criteria at the bus stand, but the other one were amber, and the two in the markets were absolutely not there. Accessibility was all not available, and the market in the all public toilets that were assessed. Affordability and availability when needed were all in amber in all the public toilets assessed. Maintenance and management of these latrines were good at the bus stand, but were very bad in the marketplaces. The requirements that caregivers and parents that were met were all not met. In all five latrines assessed, these requirements were not met. Factors affecting operators' job performance were seen specifically in the market. All the criteria for the job performance were not met. Likely score that at the bus stands there was an average performance, but at the market this were very bad performance. So the summary of the findings: public toilets in the markets were poorly maintained and unclean. No toilets were meeting accessibility requirements. No toilets contained menstrual hygiene products. Presence of water would have improved the toilet significantly, but it was not there. And there are quick things that are possible to be done, including placement of hooks, ledges, and accessibility aids. Back to you, Priya.
Thank you, Gloria. So in India, we conducted the assessment in the city of Bhopal, which is the capital of Madhya Pradesh state, and we covered 14 public toilets and 4 community toilets. Observations of these facilities were recorded through the MWater app, and we also conducted interviews of users and caretakers of these facilities. So sharing some key findings here, we found most public toilets to be unclean. And in many facilities, privacy was a key challenge due to the lack of doors at the entrance, such as the one in this picture, and also due to the location of facilities, such as hand dryers, vending machines, etc. We also found that hand washing stations were present in most facilities, but soap was not available in most of these locations. Next slide. Most of the accessible toilets we came across were common for both males and females, and while many of them had a raised seat and handrails, several other important accessibility features were found to be missing. In community toilets, MHM and waste disposal facilities were a common concern, and some users also reported discrepancies in the process of fee collection and also the timings of these facilities. Interestingly, in all the facilities we visited, there was one cubicle designated as child-friendly, which had a curtain instead of a door, but then all the other features were exactly the same as other cubicles. So it was not child-friendly in practice. Next slide. Based on the presence or absence of several such indicators, we provided scores to the facilities on the basis of 6 broad criteria for female-friendly toilets, which are listed here in this table. So we can see that requirements of caregivers was a key challenge in both public and community toilets. Similarly, maintenance, affordability, and accessibility were also challenges in both these types of facilities. In terms of hand washing and MHM facilities, public toilets seem to have fared better than community toilets. And lastly, in terms of overall safety and privacy, both types of facilities seem to be doing better with some need for improvement. And based on this assessment, we have come up with some recommendations. So some of the short-term or easy wins which we have suggested include the provision of hooks, shelves, soap dispensers, fair user fee, MHM waste disposal, etc. And in the medium or long term, we are suggesting a stronger user feedback mechanism, training for caretakers, and accessible cubicles for females. Thank you. Passing on to Priya.
Thank you, Kanika and Gloria. So in total now, WaterAid has done these assessments across 5 different countries. But our purpose is not to compare across countries, but rather it is to be able to provide a status report that is relevant to each town or city's planning processes. But we did identify issues that were common across all of the assessments that we have done, and these are laid out on this slide. For example, cleaning issues were common across all of the assessments, but with different causing factors. There was also a recommendation across all assessments that we've done for the government to take a clearer role on setting standards for female-friendly toilets so that these can be applied in practice. And equally, in most toilets that were assessed, there were not menstrual hygiene products available in the toilet block itself. However, most of them did have it within 30 metres of the block, of the toilet block within a shop in the area where the materials could be purchased. Talking to others who maybe are interested in doing similar assessments, you can find the female-friendly public and community toilet guide in these locations, and please do get in touch with us if you have any more questions. Thank you.
Okay, so if you can join us, I'm letting you in now, Gloria. Hello, Gloria.
Hello, how are you, Tanja?
Okay. Hi. Priya? Yes, good.
Hi.
Okay. Let's try the discussion mode one more time. It worked really well yesterday. Priya, I see that you already started a discussion with Brian regarding the guides. So do you want to just say something about it live?
Yeah, sure. So yeah, Brian's question around, are there more specific guidance, I suppose, to the level of engineers and planners on more of the detail? And like I said in the chat, there are, and actually my colleague Gloria, who's the technical lead, can probably comment more on this, but for one that I've posted there is actually one that WaterAid has, which is more around the technical specifications to put these things into practice. But one reason that this particular guide was done in the format that it was done is because there was a gap in we assessed that there was a gap in like clearly displaying what it means to be female friendly, and in some cases reiterating what it means to be more accessible at these, in these spaces, in these public and community spaces. And so this drew from a lot of existing work that is already out there, but tried to put it in a more pictorial, more easily digestible, more concrete way. And then the important thing for us is to include that assessment, to include how you do an assessment at a citywide or a community-wide level or in particular places, to then allow some actions to be put into process. Like some of the, what we learn from the assessments is quite illuminating, and therefore then in what are the areas of specification we need to focus on. Thanks.
Thank you. I think that Brian also had another question about the design standards. In Bhopal and India, are there design standards?
I'll leave it to Kanika to reply. Okay.
Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah, in India, there is an advisory for public and community toilets, which was issued by the Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs at the national level. So that is covering public toilets and community toilets at a broader level, not specifically only for the female-friendly toilets. So it has some broad design guidelines and also some guidelines for maintenance of these toilets, though it's not it's not capturing all the parameters in much detail, but it's quite helpful. I've pasted the link of the advisory in the chat.
Yes, you're very well prepared, all of you, I can tell. Can you say, Kanika, what are the, for your table that you show results from Bhopal, what would be the requirements of parents and caregivers? Which parameters have you considered?
I could also respond to that. Okay, so I think for the caregivers and the parents, firstly was the changing place of which I think most travelers or people who goes to the public places with small babies who needs a changing place, they do not find out a changing place. So you find if it's a small child that is not able to stand alone to use the toilet, then the mother will always have to struggle to do so. As well as the access of the children, because the toilets are a bit higher. So you find that the toilets are only for the adults. They're not child friendly as well. So that is something that we thought it is important to put into the parameters so that when the decision makers and the policymakers are building all the, installing these facilities, then they have to ensure these parameters are taken into consideration.
I see, thank you. Are there any other questions for our presenters? I see that Marie is already answering questions about the previous presentation. But any other questions for Gloria, Kanika, and Priya?
Presumably people can just turn their mics on.
Yes. Yeah, so you can just ask your questions without typing.
I have a question while we're waiting. Maybe it's not the same in the case study cities you were looking at, but for example, here in the UK, there's a real shortage of public toilets. How do you address this issue of commitment by city authorities, ministers, to provide sufficient public toilets, full stop, let alone public toilets that have all the requirements for being female friendly, etc., fully accessible? Is there a huge barrier you have to overcome to ensure investment is going into public facilities? And then with this additional expectation, or is there money there to make provision?
Priya, do you want to go first? I can go first. Okay. So firstly, thank you, Rebecca, for your question. I think it's very true that in the public sector, the government is not investing as much, and let alone having all these criteria as an addition. But I think the best approach right now is to have a sanitation marketing approach, which mostly the investors who are going to provide the service, who will also collect the revenue. These are coming up, especially on the main roads where big buses are passing through. So the services are provided, and they can either be at the hotels where people will always go to eat, and so that this is a balanced way of providing the wash services. The accessibility in these locations are provided. Mostly they've been on the accessibility with people living with disability, but then they are also well labeled, but there's some parameters that are still not there. So this is something that I'm seeing, that with these the guideline, it will also improve onto the new ones that are going to be constructed, as well as if at all the government will take that into consideration in investing into the public toilets, then the guideline can support onto the design.
Maybe the only thing I would add to that is, and our colleague Andres is online, who does more on this kind of policy change around the existence of that sanitation in the first place. But Tanzania and India were two case studies that we shared, but this assessment has been done in a number of other countries for water aid. And for example, in Nepal, in Uganda at a different level, and in Bangladesh. And what we have found what's kind of come up in those cases is, especially in places like Nepal when they've done, and Uganda when they've done that assessment with their local government colleagues. So this has not been done for them, it's been done in partnership with them. That is part of the process of then the advocacy and raising the political will for A, the improvement, and B, the amount, doing that scan across the city and then seeing where the gaps are, seeing how they are disproportionately spread for those countries anyway, that has been part of the process of working with the local government to do the assessment in the first place.
I guess a follow-up to that, if someone has a question, jump in. Otherwise, I have a follow-up.
Go ahead,
jumping in. So I'm just wondering if you're experiencing, maybe Andreas has experience of this, that raising these kind of issues that perhaps have been hidden otherwise about the need for more accessible, safe, dignified facilities. Do you find that by having those conversations with the authorities that it does actually then put raise attention to the importance of improving access for everybody? So so you may get a bigger win rather than saying we need female friendly facilities. Yes, we do. But also, look, your provision is poor across the spectrum, so that you might then hit more targets. Have you found that at all? Either yourself or, as you mentioned, Andreas perhaps has more on that from the policy side. I'd just be interested to see if that is something that happens.
Andreas, please go ahead, or Kanika or Gloria.
I think you can speak.
Yes, we can hear you, Andreas.
Do you want to talk?
No, I was just thinking. I think that Kanika has better insights than I have, because I haven't been engaged in the day-to-day conversations, and she might involve us. We cannot hear you, though, Kanika, at the moment.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, so in India, actually, there has been quite an improvement in terms of the access to public and community toilets under the recent sanitation program, Swachh Bharat Mission, by the government. But challenges still remain. The major challenge still remains in terms of the operations and maintenance. So that is something which we have been trying to address in our conversations with the authorities. And in case of Bhopal, it seems that there is some willingness to address this. And also, I would also like to share one recent initiative wherein colleagues were involved in supporting the Delhi government in capacity building of the local officials and also the engineers and architects who are involved in the design of some of these toilets in Delhi. So that basically now, after this capacity building gets over, these officials and engineers, etc., they will be involved in scaling up some of the female-friendly toilets, which are termed as pink toilets in Delhi, across the city. So that is looking something promising.
Thank you. I see that the bot is typing his question. Would you like to ask that question? Oh. Shall I read it, or do you want to ask it yourself, bot? Okay. So the comment is that appreciate if you would share key recommendations for sustainable use of public toilets. Also, I request to share behavioral part of the users if you have. Who wants to take this?
I can go. I think it's a good part of which in this assessment we had seen on the recommendations, as lastly it been mentioned that the operation and maintenance is one thing that was seen, which is is lacking. So that when we have the facility, operation and maintenance comes in as a key. When people are seeing a good facility, but it is very dirty or it's not well maintained, they will also not use it. So I think the operation maintenance is, will be one of the recommendations to the government or to the operators or to the institutions to take a keen look at, so that the latrine services can be sustainable. As well, I think with the behavioral part of the users, because the most of the public toilets, the users are one-time users, or it's not the very permanent. I think it's quite difficult to monitor, because they're either coming from different locations of the countries where there are developed toilets, or there are absolutely no toilet. So it's a bit varied. The important part, I think, is placing the nudges and cues so that people can either follow, or they can go to wash their hands after the use of the toilet, or they can properly flush or like clean the toilet before the other user comes in, so that that is the behavior which the different users will do when they're using the toilet, so that because they are coming from a very different location. That's my quick thought of now.
Anything else to add from Priya?
Yeah, I also wanted to add that from the experience of India, we think that capacity building of the caretakers and attendants of public toilets is very important, and ensuring that they are getting adequate support in terms of, grievance redressal and other material supplies, etc., is also important to ensure that public toilets are clean at all times.
We have a question from Fiona. Fiona, do you want me to read your question, I guess? The question is about the female-friendly toilets. So does female-friendly toilet fit for men as well? And if we build more female-friendly toilets, then it also increases access for wider target users.
I can respond to that one, because I think it's an important one that keeps coming up. The design, of course, works for everyone. What the purpose of thinking about what are the particular female friendly and accessibility requirements is, because the standard default toilet design that we have all been working with does not think about these things. The standard everyday practice has been more has been shaped with these things maybe not at the forefront of the mind. So the idea is that these, you know, the design is not fundamentally different, it's adding aspects that make it a better, it caters more to those additional requirements that females that have not traditionally been thought of into the standard practice. We know that we know that so many people doing the designing, the implementing, the building are male. These things are not at the forefront of mind. The planners, the decision makers are often still male. These things are not coming naturally to the front of the mind. So therefore specifying it is very, very important. However, what it ends up doing is giving universal access, right? What it does ultimately is increase universal access. And we are moving more and more to thinking about this as universal design. These are the principles of universal design that will meet everyone's need in a society that is made up of very, very different abilities, ages, and experiences. So that's, and more than one gender, you know. And so in some places, in some countries where it is on the agenda to talk about, they are also considering aspects of like transgender and third gender toilets. Where does that fit into this mix? But that has to be a very locally and context specific piece that's added in. And some of our India and Nepal, for example, have these elements in mind, maybe not so much in other places because it's not so appropriate there. That's what I would say for very much serves everyone's need, but we have to recognize that the standard design, the way that we've been going about it, hasn't had these things equally in mind, considering this is 50%, if not more, of your standard toilet user.
Thank you very much for that answer. You see that you got a big applause as well from Dani. So, any other questions for our authors?
I was just going to add an observation on your point, Priya, particularly because of this, the interest in the morning session of learning from history. in the UK, when they were designing public toilets, particularly in London, where it was seen as important to get facilities for people moving around the city, you could look at a footprint, a plan view of public toilets for men and public toilets for women. And they had exactly the same footprint, overall space. But for women, they had very few tiny, tiny cubicles and lots of space for women to beautify themselves. And then the men had lots and lots of toilets and urinals and less space for the sort of interaction. And that became the sort of standard for public facilities. Women want lots of space to chat and, you know, put their makeup on, and they don't need so many toilets. And that, you know, the engineering that got into the psyche for the male engineers and designers, I think that that's part of the reason we have these issues, is that there's a history of how design and provision has rolled out through the centuries. So some of those points that Richard Francis was raising earlier, we need to learn from the mistakes of the past. And also that Louisa was challenging us to think about who are the significant yet often ignored users. And as you say, probably over 50% of the population in some situations. So yeah, we need to carry on that message and understand sometimes where it comes from, where these attitudes have come from. So. Any more questions or observations or comments from our audience, our colleagues? Very often, our friends in the sector. Feel free to open your microphone and add a comment.
Yeah, we have new links posted by Andres. Okay.
Are there any chat? They all want their tea break or their coffee.
It seems so, yeah. Yes. Well, no. I think if there are no more questions, Danny is typing. It's a good book on history.
Can our colleague Marie come in, or is she not?
Is she here? No. Oh, you mean the of course. Well, if she wants to add something, let's invite her into the discussion.
Maybe she still can't.
Well, I just invited her to join in, but I'm not sure. Marie, can you hear us? No. I see that some people are still typing. Again, if you just would like to join in, that's fine. You don't have to type. Marie, we cannot hear you. Well, I think that Marie, you should probably go to the cafeteria and try to establish communication there if there are some additional questions for you, because something is not working here directly. Okay, there are some comments regarding earlier presentations as well. Joanne says, I would enjoy someone applying the assessment to public toilets here in the UK. I think they score very poorly. You may be right there, Joanne.
Indeed. I mean, there is the big Changing Places campaign to try and get sort of fully accessible, fully functioning toilets for many range of users. But they're big, they're expensive. assessment and the public toilets are being closed very frequently. There is the issue. I think that the issue we face here is the financing. So, and who keeps facilities affordable. And then there's the challenge that if you have to pay, the public, including myself, find that rather frustrating. You've got to have the right money to get into the toilet, because most of them are now automated payment. And if you can't get in, it becomes even more frustrating. So I hope that doesn't become an issue in these facilities, that they become a sort of physical or a financial barrier for people accessing them.
One thing that's part of the assessment actually is, and is quite an important part that maybe sometimes we haven't paid enough attention to, is the consultation with users. As Gloria said, sometimes users can be very transient, so it's hard to capture. But when we're doing these assessments, it's really important that we take the time and the energy to do some of that user consultation that provides that stuff that a visual assessment can't deliver. So those are those barriers around affordability, around and other barriers that will be there. And including that is very important at the beginning stages, right, to get so that we're tackling them right. That's also about location, understanding whether someone feels that the location, people feel the location is in a safe space. We'll only understand that by talking to users, particularly female or other users that might feel compromised in that space. So it's a very important part of the, and the only thing I will add, and I can see Marie is now with us, but the other thing, we have done research in East Africa around COVID and gender, and one thing already coming up in that is that the closing down of public toilets has had a massive impact on the women and the girls that were interviewed for that. And yeah, I'll stop there.
Okay, Marie, can you hear us now?
Yes, I'm here.
Oh, you are? Okay, we can hear some background noise, I guess. So, Marie, you, I think, already answered to most of your questions, but would you please just want to give a summary of the answers that you provided and what you think are the main points that you would like to make?
Please, I'm not alone. I will be assisting my colleague, but she speaks.
Yeah, hello, sorry. Actually, I was assisting her. I'm Kambu, Translation and Interpretation Coordinator for West Africa Region. So I was actually trying to type out the answer in the chat box. So she just said, I can answer your question, sort of give a summary of what she has put into the chat box. So I think one of the key lessons that she's not mentioned is that at some point you see that those users, the wheelchair users, put on weight, and then it certainly affects or impacts the resistance or solidity of the wheelchair. So this is one of the recommendations was to ensure that it is very strong and then can be used by, I mean, a variety of users, like including those who are, well, I would say maybe plumper. So, and then the other question was related, if I'm not wrong, let me go back to the chat box. Again, it was related to, I think, Brian's question, or no? Brian's question on whether...
Everybody needs a chair, yes. Yeah,
for people with disability but not have mobility. And then the answer she provided was, and when they were designing the facility, I mean, the chair, the focus was on people living with a physical disability. So the other disabilities were not taken into account. And she gave the example of visually impaired people or other disabilities. So focus, the exclusive focus was on the physically disabled people. And I don't know, what was the last question? There was another one from Aura. Aura, I think. That's a question. And then the answer from her was just the need for us to certainly see how we can adjust, how we can adapt the latrines for the wheelchair user to certainly have access easily. So I think that's it. That's what I've been able to see. There was another question from Scott, Rebecca. any concern with the wheelchair users? And then I think she said no. I mean, so far the answer is no. And then she's saying that actually all the users that they have come across, they saw, they were very, very happy of having a wheelchair that can be for multiple users. So they were more really not complaining about any sort of things related to that. Back to you.
Okay, I guess since you're here, thank you for that. And since you're here, if there are any other questions or comments regarding this presentation, I think we can now have people asking those questions or just join in the discussion.
Great.
Anybody?
Il y a deux personnes qui auraient aimé poser d'autres questions à l'équipe.
Okay.
I have a question if they are open to.
Yeah, of course, please.
To ask my, I wonder, building on your response, Marie, have you got any plans to consult with other disability groups about how they can, you know, what adaptations are needed to cater for them, make it more easy for them? For example, visually impaired or other groups.
Puisque tu as eu justement l'occasion, puisque l'accent a été mis sur les personnes physiques, hein, handicapées physiques, là, est-ce qu'il t'est arrivé, tu as eu du temps de pouvoir consulter, hein, échanger avec les autres groupes qui sont des personnes visuelles pour voir comment adapter ça à leur vie? Mm. Talk, et puis je vais. I was translating the question to her actually. No, the answer is no, because initially the project was initiated, was designed to focus exclusively on the physically disabled people. So no further consultation, no consultation has been carried out for other disabled groups. No. And but she's just adding that she's sure that there are other colleagues who have been involved in the design of this WASA share. Maybe if they have got some additional inputs, this is time for them to do so.
Just thinking, a couple of minutes left, but just thinking about the issue of other types of physical disability. People have upper body weaknesses as well, maybe missing arms, hands. And I think that's an area that often isn't considered in terms of sanitation needs. And we had a student who looked at this a couple of years ago for their research project. I will see if I can find that research and if it's possible to share it. But I think that's another area to consider, because we often look at people who need to be in a wheelchair for mobility, but a lot of people have other physical challenges that perhaps are less accounted for. So I'll put that out there as an area to consider rather than any solution. But if people have guidance or recommendations, then maybe share that as well.
Okay, thank you, Rebecca. I think that we better close this session. We only had two presentations, but we managed to cover the entire time slot of 1 hour. So obviously, this was a very interesting, these were interesting topics to discuss. So thank you very much to our presenters. Very good. And we will now have a 15-minute break, and then we will go to the last session for the sanitation systems and services, which is session 3H, starting in 15 minutes from now. So thank you everybody for attending, and also to our presenters for presenting. So we will see you then in 15 minutes time.